Prime Minister sidelines ministers over Manumanu land deal.
We'll step aside.
New hydropower project launched to boost city supply. And still no justice for Rabaul Queen passengers' families.
This is National MTV News with Helen Sayer.
Good evening and thank you for joining me for Monday's news. In a dramatic turn of events this afternoon, the Prime Minister announced the sidelining of two of his ministers, Defence Minister Dr. Fabian Pork and State Enterprises Minister William Duma. This is over the alleged land grabbing at Manumanu for the relocation of a military base. The Prime Minister also announced a commission of inquiry into the matter, which he expects to be completed before the March session of Parliament. We'll bring you that story later in the bulletin. 5 years on, and the families of the passengers on board the MV Rabaul Queen that capsized in rough seas and sunk off the coast of Inchafin are still waiting for justice. On the 2nd of February 2012, the ferry had over 300 passengers on board when it capsized. Around 200 survived, while more than 150 are still missing. The family members of those who lost their lives, the survivors, and those who work closely on the case still live with the sadness and trauma. Bethany Herman with this report.
It's been 5 years since the MV Rabaul Queen sunk off the coast of Inchafin, with over 300 people on board. But the families are still waiting for justice. Last week, Thursday, was the anniversary, but the wait for closure has taken its toll on those who lost loved ones in the tragedy. Mary Kiputung from Butibam lost her daughter, the breadwinner of the family. After the daughter was lost at sea, her father developed high blood pressure and suffered from severe depression. He passed away a year later.
Augustine Michael, Emolugoidan, Ladislasi, Rabaul Queen. Go bit old ring now, talk save and play like go no god. Sipi go down, Rosiasi.
Mary's story is similar to many families who had to pick up the pieces and move forward in life. It's been 5 years now, and the pain is still real for many. Celine Yep shares her story. Her family is one of many that were affected by the worst maritime disaster in Papua New Guinea's history. Her husband, Tommy Yep, who is now retired, was the chairman of the group pushing for an inquiry. He has suffered from two strokes, and her son, a survivor, attempted to take his own life twice.
How long will it take for this matter to be solved once and for all? Is the justice system with us for the simple people?
KCM taking this long due to the fact that one of the factors was funding.
While the families are dealing with their loss, there are those who work closely with them. Policemen like Inspector Russell Egenbari, the deputy lead investigator in the Rabaul Queen disaster, was also personally affected by the number of people lost and the witness accounts he had to sit through.
What happened was that he told his mate, or me one survive now picking blow me no show up. So what happened is just he just went back into the sea. He's never found again.
The Rabaul Queen disaster inquiry and investigation has cost the state over 1 million kina. And it has cost families resources and money. But most family members say more has to be done for justice and to bring closure to a case that is already a half a decade long. Bethany Harriman, National MTV News, Lae.
Another five soldiers were identified as part of the group of soldiers involved in the confrontation at the Boroko police station on New Year's Eve. PNGDF Commander Brigadier General Gilbert Taropo told the media that the Defence Force is waiting for police to interview the five. Commander Taropo said once the police interview is conducted, the five will be disciplined under the Military Code Act.
So far, seven soldiers have been implicated in the confrontation. They were identified as soldiers from the 1st Royal Pacific Islands Regiment at Tarama and the 4th Support Battalion at Mari Barracks. NGDF Commander Gilbert Toropo said while police will be interviewing the five soldiers through civil proceedings, they have to identify the police officers allegedly involved in the assault which instigated the confrontation. Police reports reveal that soldiers assaulted police officers at the Boroko police station on New Year's Eve. The confrontation was in retaliation to what soldiers claimed was a group of policemen who assaulted two soldiers and their families at Tarama. One of the two soldiers is facing a charge of being in possession of an unlicensed firearm. That case is before the Boroko District Court. Thekla Gunga, National MTV News.
The trial involving former NCD Metropolitan Superintendent Andy Bawa was adjourned to Wednesday. The adjournment comes after there were some inconsistencies with affidavits filed in court. The case was heard by Deputy Chief Justice Sir Gibb Salika at the Waigani National Court.
The case was listed for trial to commence this morning, but because of the inconsistencies in the affidavit, it was adjourned to Wednesday. The adjournment will give time for lawyers to prepare for the trial on Wednesday and sort out the inconsistencies. Bawa was present in court with his lawyer and he appeared from police bail. Bawa was arrested and charged in May 2016. His case was committed to National Court after the Waigani District Court found sufficient evidence against him. Bawa's trial involves two counts of stealing and misappropriation. The allegations are that when Bawa was the NCD Metropolitan Superintendent, he stole over 80,000 kina. That money was given to the NCD Command for the 2015 Pacific Games. Thekla Gunga, National MTV News.
Deputy Chief Justice Sir Gibb Salika today told lawyers that the courts do not have powers to control police investigations. The Deputy Chief Justice reminded the lawyers because lawyers representing Justin Parker, who was charged for murder, took a long time to inform the court why they were not ready to go to trial. Justice Salika said the court is not interested in how police conduct their investigations, but their evidence in court.
The case was before Justice Panuel Mogis, but because he personally knew persons involved in the case, he swapped the case with Deputy Chief Justice Sir Gibb Salika. Parker's lawyer said court documents were ready, but an order issued by Justice Mogis in 2016 directing police officers to conduct investigations was delaying their trial preparations. Justice Salika told lawyers this morning that the case was going on for over 18 months and wanted to know whether both lawyers were ready for a trial. He said, and I quote, "How long will we wait for a trial? If the state is not ready, then proper applications can be made." End of quote. Justin Parker was charged for the murder of his employee in 2015. He was remanded at the Bomana prison outside Port Moresby until he was granted a Supreme Court bail in November 2016. An additional court order was granted as a bail condition for Parker to leave Port Moresby for the funeral and burial of his late wife. Parker's case returns on March 6th for a trial date to be set. Thekla Gunga, National MTV News.
The legal fraternity in Mount Hagen, including police and correctional service, were told to maximize the court's time to fast-track cases at the National and Supreme Court. Mount Hagen Senior Resident Judge Justice Kenneth Frank said this last Friday at the opening of the 2017 legal year in Mount Hagen. The dedication ceremony coincides with the welcoming of another resident judge, Justice Harold Terence Falls, adding to three resident judges.
The dedication ceremony started with a walk from Hagen Drive to the Apostolic Church for the ceremony to take place. After the ceremony, Justice Frank told the legal fraternity and the disciplinary forces that this year will be a challenging year for the courts because of the national election. He urged lawyers to dedicate their work and actively push their cases in court to fast-track matters as well as disposing them quick.
And that requires the dedication of the lawyers, and in respect of the complainants or persons who institute actions, it is then incumbent on each and every one of you to...
Mount Hagen currently has three resident judges. They are Senior Judge Justice Kenneth Frank, Justice Robert Lindsay, and Justice Harold Falls, who just replaced Justice Godwin Poole. Justice Frank said there were more than 4,000 civil cases pending at the National and Supreme Courts in Mount Hagen before 2013. That was because there was only one resident judge. He said the progress of civil cases have begun slowly after he was sent to support the former resident judge of Mount Hagen in 2015.
Progress of civil cases have been slow due to the number of judges and the caseload. And so what happened during that occasion or during those times where the cases were being listed on a monthly basis at what is called the callover.
Justice Frank said Mount Hagen have also backlog of criminal cases dating back to 1996 that needed proactive action to move the cases forward. With the national elections nearing, he urged lawyers to make use of the court's time so that the court can step in to assist and fast-track all matters. Basenata Yama, National MTV News, Mount Hagen.
You're with National MTV News. We'll be back with more local stories after the break. Stay with us. Welcome back. To our earlier story, in a dramatic turn of events this afternoon, the Prime Minister announced the sidelining of two of his ministers, Defence Minister Dr. Fabian Pock and State Enterprises Minister William Duma. This is over the alleged land grabbing at Manumanu for the relocation of a military base. The Prime Minister also announced a commission of inquiry into the matter, which he expects to be completed before the March session of Parliament.
At no time did NEC has ever given any approval that all transactions above 10 million kina that needs to come to cabinet for its approval did not happen.
The announcement was made in the presence of other coalition members. Two will be caretakers of the vacated ministries.
All the Ministry for State Enterprises will be taken care of by the Honorable Charles Habel, while at the same time looking after the Planning Ministry. And the Ministry for Defense will be looked after by Honorable Mao Zemin, the Minister of Fisheries.
This is the result of a line of questioning and investigations following this question in Parliament last week.
What is the exact amount paid for the land? Is it 61 million or 50 million, or what is the exact amount paid? What is the size of the land? Question two. And question three, who has the title for the land?
The Prime Minister has conducted his own initial investigations and has come to some concerning conclusions that 78 million kina of public money was paid to private individuals for land that should already belong to the state.
It appears that individual government agencies have taken it upon themselves without proper checks and balances to undertake land acquisition arrangements.
The sidelining of the two ministers is only the start of suspension of people who may have been involved in the land deals.
I further recommended to NEC as of today, and tomorrow when NEC sits, we will be recommending for the suspension of the Secretary for Defense, the suspension of the Secretary of Department of Lands and Physical Planning, the suspension of the Valuer General, the suspension of the Managing Director of Kumul Consolidated Holdings, the suspension of the Managing Director of MVIL, again pending this outcome of this investigation.
The Commission of Inquiry could go down in PNG's history as one with the shortest time frame.
A significant focus of this investigation will be on the sale and purchase of portion 406 in Manumanu at the cost of over 46 million kina by Kumul Consolidated Holdings, and also portions 422 for 7.2 million kina, portion 423 for 9.2 million kina by the Department of Defense. Other land transfers to be investigated are land portion 406, that is owned by Kuramba Estate Limited, portion 422 owned by Flystone Limited, portion 423 owned by Kosi Investment Limited. In addition to that, Department of Defense acquired further portion 698 behind ATS at a cost of 15.4 million kina from Kitoro number 64 Limited.
Along with the Commission of Inquiry, the Prime Minister will be making referrals to the Police Fraud Squad and the Ombudsman Commission.
This investigation will include the investigation of conduct of senior officials of the Department of Defense, Department of Lands and Physical Planning, Kumul Consolidated Holding, Office of the Valuer General, Office of the State Solicitor, Department of Treasury, and the Motor Vehicles Insurance Trust. These investigations will also include private sectors, people who owned those portions of land, and how everybody else who were involved in the sale of this particular land. I have also noted, as I said, funding of 406, portion 406, which was derived from MVIL as part of this investigation. And again, it will look into the conduct of the board and the management of both MVIL and KCH.
As for the recovery of the money that has already been paid, steps will be taken to recoup it.
One of the recommendations to Cabinet tomorrow is we are seeking legal advice how we can freeze some of the funds that we have already stopped being transferred from one bank to the other to protect public interest. We have to do it in a legally acceptable manner. These are directions that are beyond my powers. So Cabinet will quickly look into it. And the directions is that many of these assets will be frozen, and in the best interest to save public monies that has been paid out unnecessarily.
Sarah Aupong, National MTV News.
A new hydropower project was launched today in the central province. The Adevu hydropower project is expected to generate 50 megawatts of power to boost electricity supply to the nation's capital. The high-profile government delegation present included Treasurer Patrick Pruaj and the sidelined Minister for Public Enterprise and State Investments, William Duma.
The Narrow Brown River, which flows from the Koyari Mountains, is the source of the Edevu Hydropower Project. The project is said to cost about 600 million kina.
The launch was a significant event that saw members of parliament and senior government officials attend. When completed, the hydro project will give much-needed boost to Port Moresby's power supply. PNG Power will buy power through power purchase certifications from the company PNG Hydro. Project manager Charles Goubet said negotiations on the project began in 2009 and has taken 8 years to get to this stage.
Therefore, Mipla Woklo Trime, best Blo Mipla long how Mipla can bring him development na service kamlo people Blo Mipla inside Lo here.
Central Governor Killa Hauda said as far as investments go, Central Province has remained a spectator and this needs to be changed. Kairukuhiri MP Peter Isoaimo welcomed the project and called on the government to facilitate and ensure equal participation for landowners.
Our people want to be a true partner in the project. Hey.
William Duma, who attended as the Minister for Public Enterprise and State Investments, said the project was an opportunity for all to work together and ensure that benefits are given to landowners.
Me can talk and me can look him or same.
This land start low one blah relationship where suppose him your leaders you honest enough, but you blah benefit yet. It depends on the kind of leadership we have in here. Now me look awesome. We have made a good start. Yes, some blah boy me blah banana looks a little of past or year ago past, but this is an opportunity where suppose you may look a long opportunity now you or sacrifice or land blame me make him. This is a chance for all of us to work together and try our best to make up for it.
The major funding of 630 million kina has come from Henan Provincial Government of China and AG Investments.
The project is said to be a giant leap for the people of the Koyari LLG. It is said to bring much vital government services which have been lacking for over 40 years. Deli Waigeno, National MTV News, Edebu Central Province.
The Lae City Manager Roy Carmen has pointed out that funding to the Lae City Council has seen significant cuts since 2013, making road maintenance and construction next to impossible. In an interview with EMTV this afternoon, Carmen said road maintenance funding was cut from 6 million kina in 2016 to 4.5 million this year. The council needs at least 30 million kina to restore all suburban roads.
As Lae's suburban roads languish in a state of disrepair, residents in places like Chinatown and East Taraka have been calling on authorities, particularly the city council, to make funding available to fix the roads. Today, the Lae City Manager, Roy Cummins, spoke out about the difficulties being faced by the City Council. Since 2013, there have been steady cuts to funding received by the City Council. This year, the funding is not even enough to complete roads in one suburb.
In 2015, we were given about 7.5 million for the road maintenance within the city. Last year, we were given about 6 million. This year we have been allocated 4.5 million. That's a drop.
So the funding is...
Funding has declined over the last 3 years. I don't know the reason why it has declined. Because obviously Lae makes a lot of money for Morobe province out of the GST that the provincial government collects. And we should be treated equally, we should be given some fair consideration and given some good amount of money to make sure we provide a service to our ratepayers in the city.
The Lae City Council, while expected to perform functions like the National Capital District Commission, doesn't have the powers to do so. The laws governing its existence make it dependent on provincial government funding.
This is different from the National Capital District Commission, which gets its funding directly from the national government through the budget. In 2015, the national government proposed the establishment of a Lae City Authority. The provincial government opposed the idea, saying it would duplicate functions of the provincial government and the city council.
Some critics argued that while the idea was good, the move was being politicized at the provincial and national levels. City Manager Roy Cummins believes a city authority is needed if Lae is to fix its suburban roads.
We are just like any other rural LLGs, and things will not work out well for us unless we get this authority status and we deal direct with the national government and we are cut off from the provincial government so that the provincial government can concentrate on the rural districts of this province, and we let the board of this city look after the affairs of the city.
For now, the provincial government is responsible for the maintenance and construction of suburban roads, but the roads remain an aspect of services that are still low on the list of government priorities. Scott Waide, National MTV News, Lae.
And now looking at our finance news, the kina closed unchanged at $0.3150 in the interbank markets. At Bank South Pacific, your kina was buying $0.3075, $0.3977 Australian dollars, $0.2827 euro, and 34.35 Japanese yen. Looking at commodity prices at New York close, coffee, cocoa, and copra closed lower, while gold closed the day higher. Palm oil and copper closed lower, while crude oil closed the day higher. And on the stock market, the Dow Jones closed at 186 points higher, The ASX is trading at 6 points lower and the All Ordinary is closed at 7 points lower. National MTV News continues after the break. Stay with us. Welcome back to the news. More than 300 families have been displaced over the weekend in Port Moresby. These are settlers who have been residing behind the Erima Bridge. They are now asking on their local members to resettle them as they have been sleeping out in the cold for the past few days.
This place behind the Erima Bridge is commonly known as Banana Block, comprising of mostly two ethnic groups from the Highlands region. It has been home for some who have been residing in makeshift and semi-permanent houses for more than 20 years. However, in the last few days, this land has been cleared off.
We got destruction come up here along last week, Thursday, the 2nd of November, between 1 o'clock to 6 o'clock afternoon. But that old land stop law, Tamblo law, bridge law, Erima Bridge, the blocks 1, 2, Jemat, or destruction all come and up. I'm all on the NAC, power one them, superintendent operations.
20 minutes of giving up, pick off. I'm only 20 minutes. I'm not thinking beginning, I'm not thinking more. All belongs to Slumilo, I didn't Slumilo. I'm hard giving the 20 minutes when the tribal man rain here. Excavated, two black excavated, one the policeman. I must load all the animal and steel man lawyer.
Settlers who have been residing here are now left with just wooden frames and roofing iron. They have no food, water, or clothing, but what's left on their backs.
Now, I'll destroy Mogeta something. I'll pull him out, all kappa, throw my plan about. Okay, I'll kiss him or something about. I'll cut him the way on top, I'll block him road. Go back, dig him ground cane, I'll block him, carry him inside, and load him all belongings, so help him all pick in the logo.
So, we plan need him some block KK, we plan and sit down. KK number, we plan for KK, we plan human being, we plan business, number number on the way.
I believe I'm becoming. One loyula, Emma said, me like him, only come helping me now. Me must find him on the ground now, me go sleep, touching down. How me problem, my mom, by me carry more beginning in around the street or same. Me school beginning blow me, uniform blow and bag up. How about me to see him? Life blow me, make him go hot.
During the eviction, families were forced to sleep outside in the wet conditions, while others made shelter at a land behind the evicted land.
Now, house here, you big plus something here, shelter blow all here. So all must find one blood proper, I'll put him all.
Now, but governor must reset all him all one blood. Can you say all 1 mile, 2 mile, and all 1 mile? Pagailia. All you victim all, I'm going to reset all him all. One can say all like him.
It is understood this piece of land belongs to the National Airports Corporation. Marilyn Diakotam, National MTV News.
Meanwhile, National Airports Corporation told MTV News this afternoon that the settlers are trespassing without their approval. NAC Acting Director and Chief Executive Officer Richard Yopo, in a statement, said the area has been a concern for them as it was a hotspot for criminal activities and not safe for travelers, employees and visitors. The penalty for trespassing would be a fine of 10,000 kina or imprisonment for a term not beyond 3 months or both. National Airports Corporation will continue to ensure the airport and its grounds are safe and secure. Vendors at Kerima Market have voiced concerns about the current state of the market. They said the market is very small and cannot cater for the increasing numbers of vendors with their produce. As a result, some sit along the pavement and outside the market to sell their produce to customers. Eric Harukma with this report.
Kerima Market is the only lifeline Kerima people use to sell their produce to earn an income.
Plus, I work in garden, plant in keke, gumo. One M plus, I CPM then I come look Kerima Market.
However, influx of vendors arrive every day from distant parts of the province with abundance of the produce to sell in the market. Negligence by those in authority has left the market idle for a number of years. This has affected locals who benefit economically from this important government service. The geological location of the market could not allow for its extension as vendors congregate along the pavement and outside the market to sell their produce.
All place line, all work, salim, all come, all highway, all come, salim, all vegetables, all sit down good, all the market and bagarap, all sit down low ground. And unsafety.
Vendors said the state of the market has been a burden for them as they have been economically affected. They are now calling on the provincial leaders to maintain this important facility which services people in the province.
So, mipla ino sabe governor blo mipla, mipla ino sabe how all put the money come down Lord Mayor na one man our controlling market blo mipla, mipla ino sabe.
Eric Arupma, National MTV News.
The Medang urban MP Nixon Duban has recently delivered several checks to various institutions in Medang, kicking off 2017 as of last month. A recent check presentation to the Metapi School, located in one of the jungle thickets in Ambenob LLG, was worth 100,000 kina. Rachel Shise in Medang with this report.
The Medang MP, Nixon Philip Duban, has dished out several checks to various institutions. That includes two schools, two churches, and also the Nanal and Dalam clashing tribes in an attempt to get them to stop fighting and work together. The checks, ranging from 10,000 kina and up, were gladly accepted by the people. The Medang MP, also the Minister for Petroleum and Energy, Nixon Duban's recent presentation was a check to the tune of 100,000 kina presented to the Matepi Primary School situated in the jungle thickets of the Ambenob LLG. Minister Duban, when addressing the crowd at Matepi, said he had to dish out 100,000 kina so that the school can take care of what needs to be done once and for all. Matepi Primary School is the school that had to be closed down in the year 2006 as a result of the Black Jesus controversy, which involved a lot of female students from the school. Rachel Shise, National, MTV News, Medang.
The Pacific Community, originally called the South Pacific Commission, today marked their 70th anniversary. The Pacific Community is the principal scientific and technical organization in the Pacific region, supporting development since 1947. SPC is owned and governed by 26 country and territory members, Papua New Guinea included.
Kids are educated, highly intelligent.
The Pacific Community was established on the 6th of February 1947. With the signing of the Canberra Agreement in Australia between Australia, France, Netherlands, New Zealand, the United Kingdom, and the United States of America. Over its 70 years, the SPC has grown into one of the primary regional bodies contributing to the development of the Pacific Island region. Headquartered in Noumea, New Caledonia, with a regional hub in Suva, Fiji, and offices in Solomon Islands, Vanuatu, and the Federated States of Micronesia, SPC worked across more than 20 sectors to support the development aspirations of member countries. Sectors include fisheries science, public health surveillance, geoscience, and conservation of plant genetic resources for agriculture and food security.
Fundamentally, SPC is there to assist the member states, particularly the island members, with their development aspirations and goals. And I think SPC has clearly done that successfully over 70 years.
According to Dr. Tukui Tonga, the SPC recognizes that development issues are complex and multidimensional and cannot be solved by a sectorial approach alone. By taking a multi-sectorial and integrated approach to responding to Pacific Islands' development priorities, the organization draws upon skills and capabilities from around the region and internationally. Leanne Gerari, National MTV News.
Turning overseas, dozens of people in the Russian city of St. Petersburg staged a protest yesterday against the handover of a landmark museum to the Russian Orthodox Church. City authorities decided to hand the running of St. Isaac's Cathedral to the Orthodox Church last month, prompting protest by city residents.
The 19th century cathedral, a famous tourist attraction, is run as a museum and is visited by more than 3 million people every year. According to museum director Nikolai Borov, the cathedral is periodically used for church services and currently uses its earnings to pay around $1 million towards its own upkeep. Every year, the cathedral spends up to around $3 million on restoration and maintenance, and urgent restoration work is needed. Borov said the takeover by the church would lead to a significant drop in revenue. Many churches and cathedrals were destroyed and turned into warehouses by the officially atheist Soviet Union. Since the collapse of the USSR, many sites have been returned to church control under several laws adopted since 1991. Another famous city church used as a museum during Soviet times, the Kazan Cathedral, was handed over to the church in 1991 and uses the funds from the state budget for reconstruction works. St. Isaac's Cathedral is St. Petersburg's third most visited cultural site and is listed as a UNESCO cultural asset. It has the largest Orthodox basilica in the world and is considered an outstanding example of late Russian neoclassical architecture. The Russian Orthodox Church yesterday received the keys of another museum, St. Samson's Cathedral, one of the oldest city churches. Lorraine Gabina, MTV World News.
Chukai Sports is next. A good start for the Lowers in their World Cup campaign. Details after the break.
Chukai Sports.
Welcome to Chukai Sports. The CPL PNG Lowers months of training proved fruitful as their World Cup qualifiers grounds practice match last Friday against Sri Lanka brought forth a 178 runs victory. Ranked number one in the East Asia Pacific and appearing in the qualifiers for the second time, the Lowers have no plans to let their less than positive results from the 2008 World Cup qualifiers in South Africa repeat itself.
Gearing up for the tournament has taken them months of training and a number of matches against Australia's best country teams to put them in the right play mode. They have two goals to achieve in this qualifier, a Women's World Cup debut and a one-day international status in the ICC. Of the 14 women in the squad, 9 featured in the Australian Cricket Country Championship as part of the team East Asia Pacific, and coach Rodney Maha believes they have prepared to the best of their abilities. Led by Pauke Siaka again, the team sailed through the first match efficiently with Siaka securing 41 runs, Konyo Oala another 42, Tania Ruma with 31 and Killa Frank with 21 runs, which set the target. The Sri Lankans' response fell short in no time thanks to impressive bowling executions from the likes of Sibona Jimmy and Ravini Owa. They were eventually bowled out for 130. The PNG side now turn their attention to Bangladesh as they will be meeting them tomorrow in their opening qualifier match. While PNG competes in the bottom four, the Super Six matches will commence next Wednesday. Dina Rose Raiko, National, MTV Sports.
The 2017 SB Hunters team saw the inclusion of 9 new players. The new Hunters boys say they are glad to be part of the team and are looking forward to the Queensland Interest Super Cup season.
Junior Rob, who made his debut for the Laysnecks Tigers last year in the Intercity Cup, was excited to have made it into the Hunters team this year.
Me also me feeling mama's true look. I'm star was me proud. I feel him also about me giving full best Lumilo this year and the Hunters.
Mukapita Kula was selected from the Southern Zone Championships to join the Hunters pre-season training camp, where he made it through to be named in the final team.
And being part of the Hunters team, it's a big honor for me to be here.
Lanky back rower Moses Meninga has added height and power to the Hunters forward pack.
I'm proud and privileged to be part of the Anders team. I used to play back row and lock forward.
Hunters fullback Stagroth Min, who has been with the team for the past 3 years, says he is confident in this year's squad and is sure they can make it all the way.
I'm proud to be back in the team and be a part of this amazing boys. And the way the boys are training this year, I think we have a better chance of taking home the trophy this year. So yeah, the forward packs are really doing the hard yards. So yeah, I'm putting my money on them. So yeah. They'll get us home.
Also making it back into the team after a two-year absence is Noel Joel. He says being back in the Hunters is a privilege and is willing to work harder this year.
I'm feeling excited about going back into the team for second year. And it's like 2 years being outside of that competition, and now I'm back in the Super game. I'm feeling glad. I'll give my best. I'm looking forward to the season and give my best at training and all this. Yeah.
Elijah Lavette, National MTV Sports.
Chukai Sports continues after the break. Don't go away.
Chukai Sports.
Welcome back to Chukai Sports. The PNG Under-17 ended their preparations for the OFC Under-17 Championship on high, with confidence boosting a 2-0 win over Onehunga Mangere 2nd Division team on Saturday at Mount Smart in Auckland, New Zealand. Head coach Harrison Kamake was pleased with the victory and said the team is now in competition mode and looking forward to the challenge that lies ahead of them. The PNG Under-17 left New Zealand this morning for Tahiti. Papua New Guinea has been drawn in Group A against host Tahiti, Vanuatu and New Caledonia. Their first clash will be against New Caledonia in the opening match of the competition on 11th February. Expressions of interest from 11 football franchises have been presented to the National Soccer League Committee in preparation for the 2017 season. This was made known by NSL competition manager Simon Koima as they target a February start for the country's biggest football competition. Koima's statement comes despite the apparent push by Hikari owner John Capinato for a proposed Super League tournament.
Koima stated that of the 11 franchises for the new year, only 2015-16 champions, Lay City Dwellers, have confirmed their interest for the tournament, which is due for a February start.
Those expressions of interest payments have not come in, so as of today, I'm still waiting. Only one franchise has come forward. That's Lay City Dwellers, apart from Besta. And I hope Mereng will come on board, and we have a new franchise, hopefully to come on board from Hagen, and we have a couple more.
With an expression of interest fee of 5,000 kina, the National Soccer League is hopeful that all clubs involved in this year's tournament will be able to confirm their participation soon, with the NSL also looking at bringing additional sponsors on board.
I believe they've done the homework and got the teams in place in order before they came and picked the information up, so it's up to them.
While Lay City Dwellers have confirmed their participation, Hikari United have stated they may branch away, forming a separate Super League competition and outside of the current PNG Football Association, as stated by Hikari United owner John Capinato in a separate interview.
Establishing this new FA is a very big issue. Now, David, Mr. Chung may be staying in New Zealand and laughing away and all that, but I think he's forgotten that the whole country is upset about it. He needs to get up here. All of us need to sit down here, and we need to talk about resolving this issue in this country.
Koima, however, is hoping that dialogue would be formed between Hikari and the National Soccer League.
There's room for dialogue. It's always available. And one must also know that it's a player's interest. So PNGFA is open. NSL is open. I'm available for dialogue.
Well, there has been consternation over the participation of arguably the best clubs in PNG playing against each other. The fact that there may be an opportunity for dialogue is at least a positive sign in these troubled times in PNG football. Jeremy Moggi, National TV Sports.
The Port Moresby Soccer Association is gearing up for a big 2017 season with the announcement that a new competition structure has been put in place and ground secured for this year. Since the last matches played were in August 2014, the association has gone full steam ahead with the preseason to commence this weekend. Vice President Joseph Eladonna says that these are exciting times for the association.
Saturday, February 11th, we've been in discussions with the Sports Foundation, and after 2 years running around, you know, looking for ovals, we're happy to be back at our home ground, Bisini. I just want all our recognized PMSA teams, you have until tomorrow, end of business, to submit your expression of interest to play. And following that, our first preference will be for PMSA teams, and any new teams coming in will consider if they want to play. That's pre-season, and it should go up till April, first week of April, and we'll start our proper season.
And that ends Chukai Sports. The weather details when we come back.
Chukai Sports. Chukai Sports.
The weather details are proudly brought to you by Dulux Weather Shield. Worth doing with Dulux.
Looking at the weather forecast for tonight and tomorrow in the southern region, showers in Port Moresby, rain showers in Daru, Kerama, Alotau and Popondeta. In the Momase region, showers and rain in all centres. In the New Guinea Islands region, showers and rain in all centres. And in the Highlands region, rain showers in all centres.
The weather details are proudly brought to you by Dulux Weather Shield. Worth doing with Dulux.
Now recapping our main stories for tonight. Prime Minister sidelines ministers over Manumanu land deal, new hydropower project launched to boost city supply, and still no justice for Rabaul Queen passengers' families. And that's been the news, sports and weather for tonight. On behalf of the entire EMTV news team, pleasant viewing. Good night.